I really want to thank CMES for the opportunity to present our paper, Julie for the kind introduction, and all of you guys for coming out on a Friday afternoon. This paper is a co-authored work with a colleague, a former colleague from Penn State, Ekrem Karakoç, who is currently an associate professor in Department of Political Science at Binghamton University. Both Ekrem and I, being from the Middle East, he from Turkey and me from Lebanon, have always been interested in identity. But this is my first attempt at going this route, so I'm really looking forward to comments and feedback. I mean, as Raymond Hinbush said, if there's anything special about the international politics of the Middle East, it is the power of identity. Over the last two decades, there has been considerable research that has been devoted to examining the relationship between identity and foreign policy. Given the centrality and significance of identity in the Middle East, there's no surprise that a lot of research have attempted to look at how identity has shaped and affected the foreign policy of Middle Eastern states. The systematic study of public opinion and foreign policy also has a long history in political science. However, similar studies of public opinion, foreign identity, foreign policy nexus is a recent phenomena in the Middle Eastern studies. In particular, if we think about works by Shibli Tilhami, Mark Tesler, Amani Jamal, and other collaborators and colleagues who worked on the Arab Barometer, they've done a great job in expanding our knowledge about public opinion in the Middle East and the role and impact on things like political Islam, support for democracy, international politics, and a whole slew of international issues in the Middle East. Now, in the aftermath of the Arab Spring, though, several studies have begun to try to investigate the relationship between identity and perception of major regional international actors. Part of the reason is there's a whole slew of researchers who are now interested, what does the public opinion who participated in a lot of these demonstrations think of these foreign and regional international actors who supported these regimes, authoritarian regime, for quite such a long period of time. On top of that, we had the outbreak of the Syrian Civil War, which all of a sudden brought this conflict almost at the same par as to the Arab-Israeli conflict and the Israeli-Palestinian conflict in particular, which had gained a lot of attention in the Middle East throughout the years. We all know the role of international actors in the Syrian Civil War, be they non-state or state, but we don't know in a systematic way how do the citizens in the region view the foreign policies of the various actors supporting the different factions in the Civil War. That is why we know that external actors are playing a prominent role in the protracted Israeli-Palestinian conflict as well as the Syrian Civil War. It's less clear what factors are contributing to the perceptions of Arab citizens themselves with regard to these conflicts. And since identity plays such an important role in a lot of these Middle Eastern conflicts, it's less clear what role identity plays in the perceptions of these foreign actors. Why Lebanon? Other than I'm originally from Lebanon, and very much interested in it. In many ways, Lebanon represents the political and social tendencies of the region in the microcosm. For example, Lebanon has 18 sects that represent the major religious and ethnic groups in the broader Middle East. Lebanon reflects the enduring political contours of the Middle East while capturing its political dynamism as well, both in its domestic as well as in its foreign policy. Given the complexity of foreign policy setting in the aftermath of the Arab Spring in particular, the multi-sectarian landscape in Lebanon makes it an ideal place for us to study the role that identity may play in determining attitudes of citizens towards foreign powers in major regional issues. In our paper particular, we examine the extent sectarian identity shapes Lebanese attitudes towards the foreign policies of international actors in two conflicts, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict as well as the Syrian Civil War. So the way the presentation is going to be divided is I'll discuss why these two conflicts in particular and how important they are to the Lebanese population, and I'll draw on social identity theory to help explain how the Lebanese might evaluate the foreign policy of the actors in these two conflicts. I'll then present our research design, discuss our findings and implications. Now, probably to many people in the audience here, it's no surprise. Since Lebanon's independence in 1943, three main actors have played a huge role and dominated Lebanese politics: Syria, Israel, and the Palestinians, both in its domestic politics as well as in its foreign policy. Given that Furia and Lucas find that Arab publics evaluate foreign actors by looking at the most salient foreign policy issues facing their country and the region, then it would be befitting for us to look at these two conflicts in the context of Lebanon. In 1948, just 5 years after Lebanon gained its independence, Lebanon faced its first foreign policy challenge, whether to participate in the first Arab-Israeli conflict. While the majority of the Lebanese Sunnis supported and wanted to comply with the Arab League, what is less known is the fact that the Shiites, the Christians, and the Druze did not. And despite the reservations about joining the conflict, Lebanon sent troops to the border to prevent any advancement by Israel. That was kind of the compromise between the different communities. The tension between the different communities when it came to the issue of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict in general and the Palestinian refugees in particular continues to plague Lebanon and even played a major role in the Lebanese Civil War between 1975 and 1990. Given that Lebanon hosts over 400,000 Palestinian refugees, in addition now to the 1.5 Syrian refugees, predominantly who happen to be Sunnis, this has become an issue of concern for Lebanese Christian and Shiites, who fear that if they were permanently settled in Lebanon, and given that Lebanon is based off of a sectarian system, 50% Christian, 50% Muslim, then this will change the power dynamics, and there'll be new demands for a shift more towards Sunni power in the government. Now, therefore, the resolution of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict becomes an important issue for the Lebanese domestic politics as well as the foreign policy concerns. So thus far, of course, the Lebanese government has not devised any viable strategy to resolve this issue. Now, the Lebanese relationship with Syria is a complicated, long history. Nonetheless, I'm going to talk about it only currently in the context of the Syrian Civil War. This is a hotly contested issue in Lebanon. And since the beginning of the Syrian Civil War, Lebanon has lacked a unified policy when it came to the Syrian civil conflict. While both the executive and legislative leaders maintained early on that they were going to stay out of this and that they would take a neutral position, political and religious figures disagreed. In fact, from within a month or two of the civil war breaking out, Lebanese Sunni fighters joined the rebel groups, and within a year, Lebanese Shiite fighters joined the government. Now, this lack of a unified stance on Syria and the contradictory position taken by the Lebanese domestic actors reflect sharply opposed views of threats and actions to be undertaken to deal with this issue. Given the lack of a unified position by the Lebanese government officials on both of these conflicts, in addition to the contradictory and incomplete information surrounding both of conflicts in the media, this has left Lebanese individuals with very few means by which to evaluate foreign policy options. As a result, assumptions are usually filtered along identity lines. And despite the competing contradictory claims, as they are sifted and with distorting effects, we believe the information and policy option will probably be filtered through one's identity. Or that is the assumption that many people make, and particularly an assumption that is made by social identity theory. Right? At the heart of the social identity theory is that group identity provides the lens and the framework by which people evaluate other groups, and it promotes positive attitudes usually towards one's in-group, and under certain conditions it can create negative ones towards out-group. Ethnic and religious identities tend to be a perfect and significant markers in many countries, and of course they generate in many cases these in-group and out-group filters. Now, if you add on top of that, which is by nature we do this, right? Social identity theory is not talking about Lebanon or the Middle East, they're talking in general, what ends up happening. And if you take the situation and you create, or you find yourself in an uncertain environment, especially when populations are living in insecure and threatening situations, individuals tend to construct threat assessments no matter what. Even if the threat's not real, you're going to construct that threat assessment. It is generally assumed that being part of the communal group means that one shares the group's understanding of political conditions, which in turn means that they share the perception of who and what is a threat. Tiffel and Turner argue in their 1979 work that individuals are likely to favor people that share group membership with them. Now, if national identification cannot foster intergroup relations or provide more positive attitudes towards, in general, trust towards outgroups becomes lower, but at the same time, it becomes higher for in-group. Under such conditions, alternative identification, such as ethnic, sectarian, or religious identities, rather than national identity, may provide the unity and solidarity and become the basis for activism, not only towards domestic actors, but also towards international actors. This is especially the case in Lebanon. Two civil wars and subsequent political arrangements interrupted the development of a national identity in the country, so the weak national identity and political institutions promoted the influence of foreign actors on the country through subnational sectarian identities. The political groups associated with particular sects bandwagon, since the 1800s in Lebanon, with external actors to strengthen their domestic struggles. Therefore, we offer our first hypothesis based off of the social identity theory, and that is, Lebanese religious groups are probably more likely to support the foreign policy of religiously similar states in both conflicts. However, this is just too naive to think that it's just identity. In the case of Lebanon, as in everything else, there's a lot of complicated dynamics in Lebanon. Syria's Western forced withdrawal in 2005 made Lebanon a new battleground in the region-wide struggle, where we had the US and its allies, predominantly Saudi Arabia, led by Saudi Arabia, and included all the other Sunni states, including Egypt, Turkey, UAE, and the other Gulf states. And on the other hand, you had Russia with its major ally, Iran and Syria, and sometimes called the Shiite axis versus the Sunni axis, sometimes also referenced as the New Middle East Cold War. The division in Lebanon mimics this regional schisms, with the majority of Sunni groups falling in line with Saudi camp, while the majority of the Shiite falling in line with the Iranian camp. However, in Lebanon, two political alliances were formed after the assassination of Rafiq al-Hariri in 2005. The first was the March 8 Alliance, which included a majority of the Shiites in the country, and this grew out of a concern with the U.S. dominance in the region. In 2003, the U.S. War in Iraq changed the dynamics, and the Shiites in particular were becoming concerned how that influence is expanding in the region. And so they thought their alliances with Syria, which was seen as part of the resistance axis, was very important for their survival, for their relationships in the region. Now, a couple weeks later, a March 14 demonstration came out rejecting the Syrian, the Syrian hegemony, as they called it, affirming their relationship with the United States. But while Sunnis predominantly in one camp, Shiites predominantly in one camp, that's not the whole scenario in Lebanon. Both of these camps divided the Christian, with a majority of the Christians being part of the March 8 camp, and divided the Druze, with a little bit majority of them being in the March 14 camp. So we have to be careful. Also, if somebody identifies in Lebanon, you don't have an option until recently to remove your identity. Right? You are born into your identity. And so therefore, you may share an outlook with US, but your identity, your religious identity, your sectarian identity may not mean the same thing. And so what we wanted to do here is we wanted to be careful about not overemphasizing identity and its impact on social and political attitudes, because it's complicated in the case of Lebanon. So in order for us to be able to investigate in our models whether or not identity has an independent effect on your political attitudes, we offer this second hypothesis where anybody, irrespective of your identity, if you're part of the March 14 camp, you're going to favor Saudi Arabia, Turkey, United States, France, and of course, you're going to have negative attitudes of Iran and of Russia, and vice versa. If you're March 8, you're going to favor Iran and Russia, and of course, you're going to have an issue with the remaining countries. So how do we go about doing this? So this was a first for me. This is the second part of this, the actual collection of the data. Ekram actually did most of it. We test our arguments using an original national representative face-to-face survey conducted in Lebanon between October 2 and 26, 2015, with a sample of 1,200 adults. The way the sample was divided is the surveys were conducted in all of Lebanon's region. We had about 10% in Beirut, 40% in the Mount Lebanon, 20% in the south, 20% in the north, 16% in the south, 12% in Biqa. The distribution of the sectarian groups correspond to their distribution in the country. So we had 27% Sunni, 27% Shiite. The Maronites were a little bit overrepresentative at 28%. Their numbers are usually around 26%. The Druze at 5%, 8%. The Orthodox at 5%, 4% Catholic, 2% other. And by other here, we are including that to include Armenian Orthodox and Catholics. Now, what did we do? The survey was a long survey, but for this paper, we really wanted to ask the respondents how would they evaluate a particular country's foreign policy toward the conflict in Syria. That was one question. And the second one was a question on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And they had to respond to a scale of 1 corresponds to strongly negative and 5 to strongly positive. Now, we had to choose the countries we wanted to investigate, and we felt that these are the major countries that represent the two axes in the region, US, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, Russia, and Iran. And we included France in there to see some of the variation that may happen, since France has not been as active, for example, as the United States and Russia. Of course, our main independent variable is each respondent's self-reported ethnic sectarian identity. So we asked respondents to identify what is your sectarian identity. And so we have Sunni, Shiites, Maronite, Eastern Orthodox, Druze, Catholics, and other Christian denominations, which mainly include Armenians. In our model, we include any other variables that may help explain the outcome, including age, gender, education, income, and a slew of other demographic control variables. Now, here I'm going to give you just a little bit the raw data to show you the perceptions of the policies. The red are the negative, the blue are the positive. One thing you automatically see, the Lebanese have a very negative attitude overall across. Now, if you listen to the politicians in Lebanon, that's not the picture they're gonna paint for you. It's a clear black and white picture, but that's not really the case. As you can tend to see as well, this chart clearly showed that the most Lebanese have a negative attitude towards the United States. Well, here, remember, they do actually have the most negative on the United States overall. It's like a 74%. And this is at this, on the Syrian Civil War. And here it reaches 81%, and only 11% assess it positively. Following U.S. are Saudi Arabia and Turkey, and they compete for the second most negative, negatively assessed countries in Lebanon at 71-70% respectively, with only 20-22% assess them positively. With respect to Iran and Russia, vis-a-vis the Syrian Civil War, the Lebanese are more or less evenly split. That is, while 50-47% of Lebanese assess Russian and Iranian policy in Syria positively, 42-46% have a negative assessment respectively. As for France, 60% of the Lebanese view its policies negatively, with only 20% favoring its policy on Syria. Now, one of the reasons why we do two conflicts is if the the social identity theory is correct, we should expect to see the same thing for both of them. And I'll get to the model in just a little bit. The one thing is, well, we see the negative drop a little bit, right? We're still seeing the same trend where the United States has the most negative perception on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, around 87%, so it's gone up, actually, while only 7% viewing them positively. Again, Saudi Arabia comes in second, followed by Turkey, followed by France. Iran receives the highest percentage of positive responses, but only at 46%, right? Remember, so in the Syrian, they'd reach 70%. In this case, Russia's positive is only at 38%, whereas in the Syrian conflict, 50. So one thing is for sure is that there's some variation here across these conflicts. Now, this is great, but from a political science perspective, we have no idea in terms of, is there a significant difference between the different identity groups, right? And so in order to do that, and to assess the country's policies, their views on the country's policies, we do a large N analysis. And I'm not gonna, I'm gonna show you a graph, don't be scared when you see it. I'm not gonna focus on it too long. I don't want you to see anything other than I'm gonna explain it and break it down. What I want you to see here in particular is to look at the stars. What the stars mean is that, is there a significant difference, in this case, between a Sunni and a Shiite, or a Sunni and a Maronite on each of these? And one thing that strikes you is, in the case of US, there's only a statistical difference between a Sunni and a Shiite, and a Sunni and a Catholic. Everything else, they view, they have the same perception. There is no difference between a Sunni and a Maronite, a Sunni and an Orthodox, a Sunni and a Druze when it comes to the United States. So we are able to do this when we have these large analyses where we can control for everything else. So I'm going to break it down to you. What does this tell us? So what our models show is that, looking at first the Syrian Civil War, is on average, while there's a clear divide between Shiites and Sunni when evaluating the policies of all countries on the Syrian Civil War, the only statistical difference between Sunnis and other sects emerges when evaluating Saudi Arabia, Turkey, Iran, and Russia. That's it. That's really where the differences among the Lebanese becomes apparent. No statistical difference between a Sunni, Maronite, Orthodox, Catholic, or Druze when evaluating France's foreign policy. So it seems that identity does not play a role in this case, all the Lebanese, a statistical difference between the Lebanese on evaluating France. The only exception, and the very interesting one, is of course the Catholics. The Catholics in Lebanon have more of a negative view than the Sunnis. Which is again, sometimes, you know, with the case of many here in the United States, have an assumption that the Christians in the region and the Christians in Lebanon are going to automatically have a positive view of the United States just because they're Christian and the United States is Christian. And that's not the case. Second, the majority of the Christian sect seem to be closer in their evaluating of foreign policy to the Shiites than really to the Sunnis on these countries' policies. They're still not as favorable as the Shiites, but they're much closer to the Shia. They're more favorable than the Sunnis across these countries. And so, for example, Maronites, Orthodox, Catholics, and even Druze tend to have more negative evaluation of Saudi Arabia and Turkey's foreign policies than Sunnis, and a more positive evaluation of Iran and Russia's foreign policy on the Syrian Civil War. Third, what is very interesting here is we find that political alliance has an independent impact on the perception of individuals. It means that even if you are a, you may be a Shiite, but if you are a March 14 Shiite, you're going to have a positive attitude of the United States and of Iran, sorry, United States, Saudi Arabia, Turkey. So it seems that political alliance has an independent impact. And we also find that individuals who supported neither alliances have more negative views of Saudi Arabia, Turkey, US, and France than March 14 voters. So what about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict? Slight difference, but overall, it still holds. There is a difference between Sunnis and Shiites when it comes to evaluating the policies of the countries in this conflict. What is interesting, though, is that the Shiites are less negative of Saudi Arabia, for example, and Turkey here than they were on the Syrian Civil War. So again, if identity only explains everything, then we should expect the Shiites to be still having the same negative view. So there's still some variation here. Yes, they still view it negatively, more negatively, of course, than the Sunnis, but not as much. The magnitude of the difference is smaller. Once again, the remaining sects seem to have similar negative view to the Shiites, similar to the Shiites, when it, especially the Maronites and Druze on Iran and Russia, and all groups when it comes to Saudi Arabia and Turkish policy. It's interesting that even on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, there is no discernible difference between Sunnis and Christians when it comes to evaluating France and U.S., despite the similarities between the Christian and the Western states. So, what does this mean, and why is this, in our mind, important for both Ekrem and myself? The fact is that this is the first systematic analysis of the impact of sectarian and political affiliation among Lebanese on their evaluation foreign policy, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, US, France, Iran, and Russia, across two major conflicts simultaneously. Our findings present a much more complicated picture of the relationship of identity and perception foreign policy. Now again, when we're talking about identity here, we're only talking about it in terms of a sectarian, in terms of how the Lebanon has defined it. There's so many ways you can define identity. Interestingly enough, we don't find much difference across gender, and other indicators. The youth were a little bit more willing, more supporters of Turkish policies, but the higher income you had, you supported Russia and Iran. So there are other factors. I mean, they weren't our main, they're in our model and in our paper, but I just didn't present them here for time's purposes. But overall, I mean, both of us have always wanted to test this out because, is that me? That is me. Of course that's me. All the times that I keep it silent, I decided not to today. What we really, most of the studies have looked at just this direct perception of an actor. They have not really asked them, how do you evaluate a country on a certain policy and to look at it in a much more systematic way. Sectarian identity in Lebanon is not always a good predictor of how the Lebanese will evaluate actors of similar or different religious affiliation. Now again, yes, with a caveat, Sunnis and Shiites more or less tend to evaluate the countries a little bit differently, where sectarian identity seems to play an important role. However, we have to be very careful, in my mind, when we think about, when we hear politicians in Lebanon, we hear politicians in the region saying, well, the Lebanese think X, or you hear some people, you know, look at one segment of the society and say, well, they all dislike, that's not true. And so with that, I'll leave it here and take questions. One of my favorite pictures from Beirut, Grand Mosque and the church in downtown Beirut. And so with that, I'll open it up to questions. Thank you.